someone who knows about a lot about risk, a lot about money, a lot about the markets, a lot about politics and lifestyle, joins us right now, Gary Goldman. Hey, Gary, how are you? Thanks for joining us.
My pleasure. How are you doing today?
I'm doing all right. I don't know how much of my intro you heard, but you know, most of my background in the markets is been for the last 25 years short selling. And I tend to get very, very nervous when a lot of the stimulation in the markets is due to, you know, unknown amounts of government money. Gary, you're really good at helping people quarterback their portfolios, focus in on long-term investing, not huge concentrations, I'm sure. What are you telling people to do? Because people are calling me like, what do I do? From my perspective as a short, I want to be short everything, but that's not the best advice for every investor out there. What are you talking about?
Well, so I want to make clear, I am not a financial advisor. What I do with companies is work with them on, you know, their overall business strategy and planning, but the financial end is a big part of it. And look, many of my clients are concerned with what's going on today in the economy, the way the government's infusing this money into the economy and investments that they have made or that they planned on making are up in the air right now. But, you know, I wouldn't want to give anyone the sense that my real expertise is financial planning. It's more on the overall aspects of business and their operations and their financial management, more or less.
Understood. But even businesses, you know, they have 401ks. They have, you know, small business owners rely on, you know, either directed or you know, financial advisors to help them with stuff. Do you see the market as a good place to be for businesses as they start to recover here? Are there values out there? Is it something that should be in their blend of initiatives?
And I definitely think it should be in their blend of initiatives. And I do think the market is going to be, as we start to recover from this and move forward, I think it's going to be a great place for businesses to be. The question a lot of clients that I work with are having is they're burning, you know, a lot of cash just to stay alive. And, you know, they look at where they are in the market today based on, you know, what's happened the last 45 days, and they're a little reluctant. But, you know, when you look at the overall picture and the way this thing has transpired, and we know that it's going to take some time to work ourselves out of it, I think the market is a solid place to be with the right advice and looking at the right investments. In order to recoup what they've lost, and they, you know, and when I say lost, you know, what has happened in the last couple of few months, they need to get back into the market. And they're all aware of it. I just think they all have a little of that fear right now.
So some interesting statements coming out of the Attorney General's office that I know you want to talk about. Bill Barr came out with some pretty strong language saying that they're going to be keeping a close eye as the reopenings begin on governors who overreach and infringe on people's civil rights. Should business owners, I mean, it seems to me like, you know, big companies like Walmart and others were allowed to stay open and their employees were allowed to be in some proximity to consumers. Shouldn't all businesses be able to make their own decisions at this point?
I definitely agree. I think businesses should have the right to open. I think, you know, with obviously proper protocol has to be in place, but there's no reason to keep many of the businesses that are closed. Like you say, how do you differentiate? You know, you can go into a Walmart, you can go into a supermarket, you can't, you know, they won't let you go into other types of retail stores. And for the infringement, I think Attorney General Barr is right on the money. I fully understand that the states had to leverage some of their strong arm to some degree and keep things in order and watch the way things were happening so that people weren't susceptible to this unknown virus. But at the same token, we're getting to a point now, you know, they moved the goal line a few times already. Let's wait till the curve settles down. Now the curve settled down as well. We really can't go back to business because we don't want to, you know, our elderly population to get sick, or we don't want to, you know, you don't want that feeling of guilt if you passed it on. So businesses have the right to be open. I think business people are smart enough to set up the protocols within their companies. I know many clients that I work with, we've already set up COVID-19 protocol, whether they're in service, they're in retail, whatever the case may be, to go forward. And even, the people that I talk to in the real estate management field, they're having a very difficult time, especially when you get involved with elevators and buildings, because people are telling them they're afraid to get into those elevators. They're afraid they're going to be susceptible to some sort of germ or disease because of being in there. So those are the types of hurdles that we have to cross. But we've got to look at, we can't keep the economy closed. The wheels of this country need to be moving. When you think of where we were as a country 6 weeks ago and we're at today, very dangerous to let this go any further. We don't want to slide into anything worse than we are now. So we've got to get people back to work. And I think the attorney general's right. I know here in Massachusetts, we were supposed to open up on Monday. Now they pulled it off for another couple of weeks. And when you have the mayor of a major city like Boston saying it may go longer than that, if I'm the Chamber of Commerce or I'm a business owner in the city, I'd be on the phone with this mayor because you can only let this go so far before it's catastrophic financially for the city as well. They won't be collecting the tax revenue they need to operate.
Yeah, no, I'm with you. And I'm not a financial advisor either. I often remind my viewers not to take any financial advice from me, but I do like to lean on, some, life career catalog of what my experiences are. And you made a great point there. I've been talking to a lot of people I know that are, in and around the commercial real estate business. And it seems like a lot, especially here in New York, where that's, probably one of the biggest businesses around, a lot of big businesses are trying to find low-rise buildings out in the suburbs where they can offload some groups of their people. And I really think that, these big, huge behemoths that own these tremendous skyscrapers across the country are in for a much longer term problem because no matter how you slice it, I want to get to work. I want to be safe. I want to be responsible. But I do not want to get in an elevator with 14 people going to the 61st floor. So this is going to be a problem for some of the biggest commercial realtors in our country, I think.
And to think that you're only going to be able to limit the amount of people on an elevator. There's only so many elevators in the building. They know the masses of people that have to get to the different floors. They'll be waiting outside around the building before they get in. I was talking to a commercial real estate manager yesterday that told me the protocol that they're setting up is there will only be enough room in the elevators for the, two or three, four people, and they have to face the wall as they're climbing up the floors. I mean, look at that's not going to work. I think everybody knows that's not going to work and it doesn't make sense. We have to figure a way around this. But the big real estate in the big cities, where people are on elevators going up several floors, they know those companies within those buildings know they have to start looking in the suburbs. Suburbs get to smaller buildings so people at least have the option of using stairwells. And stairwells are becoming an issue too. Managers are telling me they want one for up, one for down. But I've got to tell you that no fire department and no fire code is going to allow that to go on.
So we've seen over the past couple of years, major traditional brick and mortar places, Sears, JCPenney, Toys R Us, go by the wayside. Bankrupt, done, out of business. There were still some, bigger chains that were trying to adapt to the new brick and click model. It seems to me, I don't know how, if many of your small businesses that you advise or consult with are retailers and malls, but I think malls and movie theaters have a very similar problem too, that people are not going to want to go to centralized places. And I think the whole brick and mortar model, this may close the chapter on it in a lot of ways.
I think you're right. Look at Simon Malls came out with their protocol in regard to opening a lot of the malls today. Food courts are not going to have any chairs to sit down. I'm not sure why you're going to have a food court there anyways. You're not going to, unless you plan on walking around and eating. Employees have in the stores have to wear masks, but the customers don't. But when you think about a given mall on a weekend, people walking, sitting, hanging around, they're not going to want to do that anymore. And I think quickly these malls are going to find out that they have a major issue on their hands. I look at if I'm one of the big real estate guys and I'm thinking of opening up malls, I'd be thinking twice right now, because once we get back to some sort of norm, whatever that may be, I think the psychological impact that the country and the people have gone through and are continuing to go through are going to be with us long after this virus passes. And that's going to have a lasting impact on businesses, brick and mortar, malls, shopping centers, and large office buildings. And I think that's something we have to come to terms with.
Yeah, I'm with you. And oddly enough, I do a lot of consulting and advisory myself to companies. And someone called me the other day with a quite intriguing idea. A pretty large landlord owner was talking about bringing back the old drive-in movie. And as crazy as it sounds, because there's only 300 of them left in the whole country, I think, there may be a renaissance of that type of thing. Most of the young kids and millennials these days, they've never even been exposed to a
Never
drive-in
experienced.
movie. And if you want to get out with the family for an affordable night and be entertained, the good old days of drive-in movies may be a solution at this point.
Yeah, there happened to be a couple in Massachusetts, not too far from where I am right now. And look at that, I think drive-ins are a great idea. And I remember drive-ins when I was growing up as a kid. You could go there winter, spring, summer, or fall. It didn't matter. They even provided at one point, I remember, little heaters that went in your car for you. But I think that's where we're getting to. I think, look at people are very unsure of what's going on. I'm not sure 100% of the people even understand this virus. I'm not sure maybe we're being told everything about the virus. I think that will come out in the long term here. But it is going to change our way of life. Everywhere you go, whether it's where you're talking to people, or you're listening to the news, or you're listening to the radio, or you're on social media, people keep talking about this new way of life. They really haven't defined what it is, but I think people are starting to grasp that things are going to change. And I think drive-ins are a great idea. I look at, there's nothing wrong with that. But movie theaters, these big complexes, even if they follow the social distance within the theater, how do you recoup the revenue that you need to pay for that overhead? You know that as well as I do. There's a number that you have to have. And when you take the capacity of your theaters and divide them by two or whatever, it's difficult to get that money up, and you can't double the price of tickets because people are not going to pay for it. So there are a lot of changes that are going to go on, and the change is going to affect real estate. I think commercial real estate is going to be something we really need to watch the next several years.
Yeah, I happen to think I've been talking to a bunch of different business leaders here in New York. I happen to think that, while everyone had their disaster recovery plans in place, they may not have been perfected as they want, but most companies I know that are working everyone 100% remote, they're operating pretty efficiently right now. But I've heard from a number of senior executives that you can really take a step back and see, who you thought was underperforming in the office, and they seem to be standing out as underperforming more. And I think on that commercial real estate note, I think, everybody's got to keep their employees for a couple of months to get their PPP money forgiven.
Right.
But after that, I think employers are going to realize that they can cull their herd. They can take those people that they know they've been carrying for years, but when you're profitable, you let some people live and hope they blossom, right?
Right.
Now they're going to take a look and say, all right, well, we know we can chop off 10% of the fat because we saw how this guy, right? And I think it's going to be not till after year end where businesses go back to 100% occupancy in their space. I think there's still going to be some stagger. Monday, Wednesday, Friday, one group. Tuesday, Thursday, another group. And as companies get more acclimated to teleworking, which I think is happening right now, I think, people are going to start to re-examine their commercial office footprint too, for their next lease. And hey, you know what? Maybe we can have X amount of people work from home on Mondays and Fridays,
Yeah.
and we don't need all this overhead in actual commercial space. So there's a lot of things changing, a lot of paradigm changes I see coming out of this.
Yeah, it's funny you bring that up because I was speaking with a company in the insurance financial market, And several years ago, they were telling me that they went to, remote work for a majority of their employees. They actually transformed offices, downsized the office space, and ended up bringing a lot of people back because they were not getting the work out of them that they were supposed to. But now he's saying we look at it a little differently. Exactly what you brought up. Now we're looking at it. We know we're going to have remote working. We're going to have to find those that are capable and, as he likes to put it, mature enough to do what they're supposed to do when they're on their own. And if they don't, it becomes part of their review process, and off they go. Because his bottom line was to me this week, there's no way consciously I cannot look at downsizing the footprint of our real estate because we never know when the next situation is going to occur. And so I think you're right. Companies are going to look at it. Employees are going to have to perform when they're remotely working. I'm not sure what type of timetable that will be on if they want them working, 7 to 5, 7 to 8. I assume it depends on the type of work they're doing, but they will have to perform. They will have to get their job done, and they will have to know that if they don't, there's a price to pay. Because I think corporations are all over the country and probably the world are going to look at ways to cut overhead and real estate and their rent or lease or whether they own the building, whatever the case may be. Need is a big number, a very big number that involves a lot of other aspects, and they need to cut that down because, God forbid, if it happened once, anything could happen again.
Well, I appreciate you joining us today, Gary. It's nice to have you finally on the show. I've been hearing about you for a long time, but I'm glad my producer got you in with us. And hopefully we can check back in with you soon and get a little update on what's happening in your neck of the woods and any good intel you're getting for business owners out there. We'd love to have your voice on the show.
Thank you and have a wonderful weekend. Stay safe.